Say, we welcome.
We welcome you.
We welcome you.
We welcome you. First Baptist Church of Bridgehampton.
Shelter in the time of storm. When everything goes wrong, he is so good. He is
so good.
He is
so good.
He is so good.
So good
to me. Then why don't you say,
why don't
you give him your best praise? love and praise you together. Come on. Everybody clap those hands. Yeah. Do your dance.
Good morning, First Baptist. Good morning, Bridge Nation. Here we find ourselves again preparing for our Sunday morning service here at First Baptist Church of Bridgehampton. And on behalf of my pastor, our pastor, Reverend Tisha Dixon Williams, I welcome you. And we don't take it lightly. We're glad that you thought it was not robbery to join us this morning. Let us pray. Most gracious and everlasting Father, the one that sits high and looks low, O Heavenly Father. We approach your throne of grace and mercy this morning, O Heavenly Father, to give you the honor, the glory, and all the praise, because after all, O Heavenly Father, you are the one and only living true God. And O Heavenly Father, we love you, O Heavenly Father. And O Heavenly Father, at this time, I would like to lift up those that are going through trials and tribulations, O Heavenly Father. As life presents itself to us, O Heavenly Father, we all go through trials and tribulations, whether it's sickness, bereavement, depression, O Heavenly Father, homelessness, financial strapped, O Heavenly Father, we all must go through these things. And O Heavenly Father, I ask that you would look down and give us your grace and your mercy, O Heavenly Father. You know exactly what we need, O Heavenly Father, and when we need it, and we depend and rely on you to provide those things. O Heavenly Father, I ask that you will continue to bless First Baptist Church of Bridgehampton, O Heavenly Father. Bless our pastor, O Heavenly. Continue to bless her, O Heavenly Father. Continue to guide her, inspire her, O Heavenly Father. And O Heavenly Father, continue to bless leaders, O Heavenly Father. Whatever position they're in, O Heavenly Father, they are responsible for others, O Heavenly Father. Make them humble, O Heavenly Father, and make them realize that it's not all about them, but it's about your people, O Heavenly Father. O Heavenly Father, we love you, O Heavenly Father, and I pray that you will continue to bless us, all your people. O Heavenly Father, this is my humble prayer in your precious Son, Jesus' name. Amen.
God gives life and he takes it away. He is the potter and I am the clay. When I view the last sunset and cross all the sea, I know the sunrise will be waiting for me. And oh, what a sunrise. It's going to be when death will lose its sting and the grave its victory. The silence will be broken and the storm clouds rose away. I hear the saints of ages singing on a homecoming day. Time will come for the last goodbye. faces of smile. No, the tears dim their eyes. Death will take us, but only to sleep in the arms of our Savior, so sweet. And oh, what a sunrise it's going to be when death will lose its sting, and the grave its victory. Oh, the silence will be broken, and the storm clouds rolls away. I hear the saints of ages singing on a homecoming day. The silence, oh, the silence will be broken. Hallelujah. And the storm cloud goes away. Hallelujah. I hear the saints of ages singing on a homecoming day. Hallelujah. And oh, what a sunrise is going to be when death, hallelujah, will lose its sting. It's victory. Oh, the silence will be broken, and the storm clouds rolls away. I hear the sounds of ages singing on a homecoming day. Hallelujah. And oh, what a sunrise is going to be when death will lose its sting and the grave its victory. All the silence will be broken, the storm clouds rolls away. I hear the saints of ages singing on a homecoming day. Hallelujah, the silence will be broken. Hallelujah. And the storm clouds goes away. I hear the saints of ages singing, hallelujah, on our homecoming. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Good morning, First Baptist, and good morning, Bridge Nation. I'm so happy that you guys could join us for worship today. Today, we're doing something special. We are doing a Bridge Nation Rewind. In honor of the Hampton Classic Horse Show coming back to our area, I thought it would be befitting if we took a flashback to around this time last year where God encouraged Jeremiah to handle his horses. This was such a great message and one of the first ones that we did on location right around the corner from us at the horse farm. And we certainly thank our friends for the use of that facility. I don't know what you're dealing with. I don't know what you're working on. I don't know what's next on the horizon for you. But what I do know for sure is that God wants you to be ready and to prepare yourself. So whatever season you're in right now, if it seems insurmountable, just wait. There's more to come. And God is encouraging you today to handle your horses. I hope you guys enjoy this rewind. God bless you.
Good morning, First Baptist, and good morning, Bridge Nation. Before I get started, I want to thank you all for tuning in again today, and I want to give a special thank you to our neighbor here in Bridgehampton, Susan Hiscock, and the Bittersweet Farm for allowing us to use their venue today. As you can see, I have two special guest preachers behind me today, Pete and Mo, and they will be assisting me in today's word. So if you would, go grab your Bibles. You know the drill, your phones, your tablets, whatever you have, however you access the Word of God, and we are going to get right to it. Today, our text is coming from the Old Testament book of Jeremiah, Jeremiah chapter 12, verses 1 through 5. Jeremiah chapter 12, verses 1 through 5, and it reads as thus. You will be in the right, O Lord, when I lay charges against you, but let me put my case to you. Why do all who are treacherous thrive? You plant them and they take root. They grow and bring forth fruit. You are near to their mouths, yet far from their hearts. But you, O Lord, know me. You see me and test me. My heart is with you. Pull them out like sheep for the slaughter and set them apart for the day of slaughter. How long will the land mourn and the grass of every field wither? For the wickedness of those who live in it, the animals and the birds are swept away. And because people said, he is blind to our ways. If you have raced with foot runners and have wearied, how will you compete with horses? And if in a safe land you fall down, how will you fare in the thickets of the Jordan? Verse 5, God replies to Jeremiah and says, if you have raced with foot runners and they have wearied you, how will you compete with horses? For the few moments we have today, I'd like to share from the subject, handle your horses. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for the privilege of being in your sacred space, to be in your creation at this sacred desk. I pray, God, that you would use me in a mighty way to preach a word unto your people, a life-affirming, life-giving word, a life-changing word, God, that your people will be edified and that you will get all of the glory. Empty me and fill me with your Holy Ghost power. I have no delusions of grandeur. I'm only what you make me in this moment. This is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Handle your horses. As the daughter of a black cowboy, the proud daughter of a black cowboy, I spent my childhood with horses, and I had one of my own. Yes, in Brooklyn, you guessed it. When most fathers were pulling into the driveway driving their Ford Broncos, my father was riding on top of one. I tell you no tales. And I learned several lessons about life while spending time with my father and caring for our horses. He was a perfectionist when it came to their training and their maintenance. Admittedly, this frustrated me because all I wanted to do was ride my horse and be a cowgirl. I wanted to wear nice boots and Western clothes. I wanted to learn how to barrel race and gallop. I wanted to do the fun stuff with little regard for what it meant to be a horsewoman. Interestingly, I found that when it comes to our Christian walks, we are often guilty of the same. We discount training and ministry maintenance in favor of the fun stuff. We want to wear the titles and be associated with Christ while never deeply committing to what it means to be Christ-like. We want to teach and preach and lead, forgetting that serving is at the core of Christianity. Indeed, the lessons that I learned from my father through horsemanship proved to be invaluable in life. Could it be that the same lessons I learned about horses from my father be the same lessons that our Father wants us to learn about how to compete with them in this Christian race? Let me give you some background. The book of Jeremiah, Jeremiah is mad, y'all. He's angry, he's worn out, he's confused and downright fed up. Have you been there? And in his frustration, as we often do, he makes a complaint to God. In fact, Jeremiah was always crying and complaining, so much so he is known as the weeping prophet and the author of the book of Lamentations, an entire book dedicated to his passionate grief and sorrow, albeit justified. He lamented because of the weight of the responsibility that God had placed on his shoulders. He lamented because God chose him to be over nations, not to encourage, but to pluck up, pull down, to destroy and overthrow, to build and to plant. He lamented because his message was of destruction, doom, and gloom. He lamented because of the people and their callousness toward God. He lamented because he was saddened by the state and fate of his people. He lamented because of the persecution he suffered at the hands of wicked kings. He was tired of facing the crowd alone. He was tired of being ridiculed. And he lamented, quite frankly, because he feared death. As God's prophet, Jeremiah was in a constant state of exertion, physical, spiritual, mental, and emotional. Life for Jeremiah was like constantly being in a hard-fought race with men. Who can relate? What hard-fought race are you running today? Are you running the redundancy of the rat race? Have you been injured by the inhumaneness of the human race? Are you drained by the daily race against the clock when all you're trying to do is fight the good fight and finish the race? Well, you see, this is where we find Jeremiah in verse 2 with that level of frustration. And here we see him acting as a prophetic prosecutor laying charges against the Lord. Jeremiah, the judiciary, charges God with two counts of conspiracy. Count one, conspiracy to aid in prosperity when he argues you plant them and they take root. They grow and bring forth fruit. In other words, you allow them to get elected. They take office and then wreak havoc on the nation. He then brings to him count two, conspiracy to aid in hypocrisy when he argues you are near in their mouths but far from their hearts. Can I make it plain for you? They stage photo ops in front of a church, Bible in hand, but never actually read it or enter into it. Jeremiah then calls himself as a character witness, testifying of his loyalty. You see me and you test me. I have been with you since the beginning. I have run this race faithfully, patiently, prayerfully, and passionately, and perpetually. How is it, Lord, that you let everyone else get ahead of me? Where is the retribution for the unfaithful? Is justice indeed blind? Do you not see what is happening, God? Jeremiah had become so obsessed with the actions of others and God's plan for them that he became weary. Jeremiah allowed people to wear him out. Whoo, that's a word for somebody today. How many of you know that people, folk, can wear you out if you let them? Jeremiah was worn out and wearied by ignorant people, disobedient people, prideful and stubborn people. And let me caution you, there is a danger to being weary. Much like the Snickers commercial promotes that you're not yourself when you're hungry, I submit to you that you're not yourself when you're weary. You can't focus when you're weary. You lack energy when you're weary. You lack the ability to make wisdom-filled decisions when you're weary. Molehills become mountains when you're weary, and you certainly cannot compete when you're weary. When you allow people and circumstances to wear you out, it causes you to lose sight of the big picture, and that is exactly what the enemy wants. The enemy wants you to become so preoccupied with the perceived progress of others that you neglect the plans that God has for you. Come on, somebody. And there is a plan. Come on and fast forward with me to the 29th chapter of this book of Jeremiah. A plan has already been put in place to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans plans to give you hope and a future. Your present chapter may be precarious, but I dare you to press toward the promise of the plan. You see, we cannot afford to let people or our work wear us out, because this is only the beginning of what lies ahead. And if you'd let me, I'd like to pause here to preach to my fellow pastors. Pastors, I imagine that we all feel a bit like Jeremiah in this season, weary and worn out. In fact, author John Hobbs predicts a coming pastoral crash. Hobbs suggested as a result of the COVID-19 crisis, our pastoral care providers are maxed out. And while it might seem that preachers' duties are relaxed, it is actually the opposite. And the impact of ministry job losses, ministry burnouts, and ministry suicide is going to be a major event for the church to deal with in the coming year. Pastors and clergy leaders are in danger for several reasons. We are serving in ways we have no training or experience for. We're in danger because we're doing our best, but we are unable to keep it up. In danger because we are worried about ministries that are unable to operate, and if they will operate in the future is what we fear. We are exhausted. We are not feeding our souls. Our future is cloudy. The collapse of the job and financial markets impacts our churches. We are physically not healthy. We have conformed to a 7-day work schedule. We are unwilling to take time off. We do not seek out mental health. I'm here to tell you today, we are in dangerous spiritual territory. We are weary and worn out. I fear that a coming pastoral crash is on the way. And in our weariness, could it be that the worst is still yet to come? Because the only thing more stressful than knowing when to close the church is knowing when to reopen it. Clergy, I fear, with the continuation of the coronavirus, with rising curves and spiking death tolls, we ain't seen nothing yet. Therefore, as Hobbs suggests, ministers must commit to ministering to their own hearts first. Engage in the spiritual disciplines, re-engage with family relationships, restart physical exercise and rest, or take whatever time you need to read and relax. Read books that have nothing to do with preaching. Whatever feeds your heart, you should do it now. Because if you're waiting for the pandemic to be over, you may not survive. I feel you, Jeremiah, wondering if you will survive. Unless we be too hard on Jeremiah, I'm sure that we can all agree that we've complained to God for much less than what he was facing in this moment. And while we may have difficulty relating to all of Jeremiah's complaints, if we're honest, there's one grievance that I believe we've all voiced at some point. Why are the wicked so prosperous? Why are evil people so happy? Here, Jeremiah speaks to the obvious injustice of a world where the wicked prosper while the righteous suffer. How is it that financier Jeffrey Epstein trafficked young girls for years and walked freely, while Walter McMillan walked the hallways of death row for 6 years without the possibility of freedom? Now, how is that just mercy? How is it that countless people have been arrested for protesting Breonna Taylor's murder, and yet the murderers themselves remain on the state's payroll, sleeping safely in their beds at night? I feel a little like Jeremiah today when I consider the injustice of a world where the wicked prosper while the righteous suffer. Have you ever felt this way? Could it be that nice guys really do finish last? Sometimes it just doesn't seem fair, does it? Are you with me? Can I make this thing personal for you? How is it that you take the lead on a group project, but your colleague gets all the credit? How is it that you worked hard in school to get all A's and make the dean's list, and yet the person who slept through class and copied off of your paper has the corner office in the executive suite while you struggle up the corporate ladder? You've been faithful to the same person for years. You supported them when they were down and out, and now that they've achieved success, they've moved you up and out. How is it that you go to the gym 3 times a week, eat your vegetables, and never skip a day of supplements, but if you swallow a grape, you gain 10 pounds, while your friend binges on donuts, soda, fast food, and is the picture of health and has not gained a pound since high school? You pray every day, faithfully. You petition God every day, worship every Sunday. You tithe and offer. You have faith, not the size of a mustard seed, but of a sesame seed, and your mountains have yet to move. While those who hardly ever pray, never worship, and only seek God in times of despair, stress, are living their best life. It just doesn't make sense. Do nice guys really finish last? This is Jeremiah's complaint and question. And I have found, as evidenced in his response to Jeremiah, when you ask God a question, you better be prepared for the answer. When God responds to Jeremiah, God does so by presenting a question of his own. Riddle me this, Jeremiah. If you have raced with the foot runners and they have wearied you, how will you compete with horses? Have you ever engaged in a conversation with God and it begat more questions than answers? That's what's happening here. You see, God is notorious for this category of cross-examination. Come here, Job. After Job's many complaints following his superfluous suffering, God did not respond with answers, but rather with questions. Where were you, Job? Do you know, Job? Let me ask you, can you, Job? And yet, God did not seek these questions for information, but rather for Job's enlightenment. Philosophy would call it the Socratic method. The Socratic method is a technique used to guide students through critical thinking in a way that it challenges and engages. Developed by Greek philosopher Socrates, the method is based on questioning techniques that stimulate discussion and critical thinking, guiding students' learning by asking questions that challenge their opinions. Socrates no doubt learned from the best, as God uses this method to challenge Jeremiah's opinions of those he believes less deserving of prosperity and God's favor. Interestingly, God does not respond to the charges set before him regarding the prosperity of the wicked, nor does he console Jeremiah as he had done in the past. It indicates for us here that there's a time for consoling, and there's a time for correcting and coaching. While the worst was yet to come, Jeremiah needs to prepare himself for the adversities that lie ahead and stop complaining about what has already come to pass. God is commanding Jeremiah to worry about yourself, because what you are facing now is nothing compared to what's coming. In other words, you ain't seen nothing yet. People are the least of your worries. Prepare to handle your horses. And I can hear someone asking, but why horses? I love horses. I go on trail rides on vacation. I take my children to the petting zoo. I still get excited when I see the Mount Police in New York City. Why horses? Sure, horses are great now, but within the cultural context of this text, that wasn't the case. Can I teach for a minute? As one theologian submits, we must consider that the Old Testament was written by and for people who had a taboo against horses. The patriarchs of the Hebrew nation rode camels and asses, but never horses. Horses were associated with foreign imperialists, the Assyrians, the Egyptians, and the Persians, and all the Hebrews held threatening. Horses were representative of their enemies and war. And now, considering God's analogy as the first phase of battle, if one could not stand against the footmen, there was no hope in surviving the cavalry. I'm going somewhere. You see, a soldier who fights on foot was known as a foot soldier, a footman. Theirs was a necessary but basic and often mundane task. The purpose of the cavalry or horsemen was to identify and break through any one of the holes that the footman had made. So the objective of the footman was to have little to no holes for the opposing forces or horses to break through. If the footmen were effective in maintaining their formation, the success of the horsemen would be greatly diminished. Are you with me? What are you saying, Pastor? I'm saying that when the enemy engages us, he's looking for holes. He's looking for some chinks in your armor. He's looking for some spaces to infiltrate when your defenses are low. And be mindful here, the enemy does not initiate attacks with big things like horses. He starts with the little things like footmen. Come on, somebody. Are there some holes in your defense that need to be closed up to prevent the enemy from getting in? Are there holes in your marriage? Are there holes in your bank account? Are there holes in your ideologies? Are there holes in your devotional life? If so, God is saying, tighten up the line. Because if you can't handle the human race, how do you expect to compete in a horse race? Watch the text. God says, if you have raced with foot runners and they have wearied you, how will you compete with horses? Notice the difference in the actions here. You see, up until this point, Jeremiah was racing. He wasn't competing. You can race and not compete. It's the difference between racing against your teammate at a track practice and competing against another team at a track meet. You have been running with footmen, Jeremiah, but I have bigger plans for you. Your hometown and the people in it have only been a training ground and the place of preparation for you. And if you have become wearied and ready to give up while running against footmen, how will you run against the horses in Jerusalem when I send you there? Let me break this thing down for you. You see, when we run against footmen, it indicates that we're only running against humans. We are on a level playing field. They have flesh and bone, you have flesh and bone. They have 2 feet, you have 2 feet. They have 2 legs, you have 2 legs. 2 arms and 2 arms. We have the same physical anatomy. The only difference between you and them is who wants it more. The only difference between you and them is who has the heart. The only difference between you and them is who has the eye of the tiger. The only difference between you and them is who's willing to go the extra mile. We are not in competition with each other. We are in competition with the horses, because horses represent new levels, new challenges. Our focus are not humans. We are training for the horses. You are complaining about a foot race when God is preparing you for a horse race. What are you going to do when the odds are stacked against you, when the playing field is not level, when you find yourself up against something that's built to run, that has more legs than you, that has more muscle than you, that is taller than you, that is designed to defeat you? What are you going to do when you come up against the horses? Jeremiah, how will you cope with the religious rulers and the evil princes and the idolatrous population of Jerusalem if you go tired and give up while you're still living in the small village of your birth? Lil Nas X said it this way, riding on a horse, ha! I've been in the valley, you ain't been up off your porch. Y'all still ain't getting it. Let me help you a little more. You see, we've all had dreams and aspirations of moving beyond our current context. We aspire to greater heights, better jobs, richer relationships, and financial increase. But here's the question. If what you're experiencing now is overwhelming you, how will you handle what's to come? Can I ask the question again? If what you are experiencing now is overwhelming you, how will you handle what's to come? If you can't handle God opening a door, how will you receive the blessing that pours through the window? If you can't sip from the bitter cup, how will you sip when the cup is running over? Okay, I got too churchy for y'all. Let me make it plainer. If the person in the cubicle next to you is wearing you out, how will you handle the executives in the boardroom? If you are struggling to make a rent payment, how are you gonna handle a mortgage payment? If dating is wearing you out, baby, how are you gonna fare in marriage? If budgeting is wearing you out, how are you gonna want to build a financial portfolio. If worshiping for 1 hour on Sunday is wearing you out, how do you expect to worship all day in heaven? I heard a preacher say there's no lazy people in heaven. You turn around and sing holy, holy, holy. You turn around some more and sing holy, holy, holy. If all of this is wearing you out, how do you expect to move to the next level? What's your horse? What's the obstacle in your life that seems insurmountable to you? Because what God has for you is bigger than where you are right now. But where you are right now is the training ground that's preparing you for what's coming. And you got to be tougher for where God is about to take you. Now, how does one compete with horses? I'm glad you asked. In order to compete with horses, you got to train like one. In fact, you must trust, train, and then you will triumph. First of all, you've got to trust. In this text, horses are used as a metaphor for the enemy, for that which is intimidating, for the unknown, for that which is out of our control. Horses symbolized war. And when you are faced with these circumstances, you've got to trust God wholeheartedly. You see, great horses put great trust in their owners. You've got to trust God to shield you from the enemy. It's a Psalm 27 kind of trust. The Lord is my light and my salvation. I will fear no one. The Lord protects you from all danger. You should not be afraid. When evil people attack me and try to kill me, they will stumble and fall. When the wars break out in your life, you've got to trust God. It's an Exodus 14 kind of trust. The Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace. Over time, we learn to trust God. With every new experience, we learn to trust God a little bit more and more. My father taught me that a horse depends on its owner to feed them, to lead them, and to take care of them. You see, my horse never worried because he knew that at 7 a.m., my dad would be there to feed him like he had done every single day. And I was told by my dad that anything you ask a horse to do is a mere suggestion. My father always reminded me that this was a 1,200-pound animal that could crush me at any time. But because of his trust that we had developed, I could trust the horse to be obedient. Can God trust you to be obedient today? You see, horses know their power, yet they submit to their owner. And it's only after trust is established that a horse can be properly trained. Training is key. Before one even begins to ride a horse, training is the foundation of the relationship. God was training Jeremiah for greater trials, greater tests, greater obstacles, greater challenges. Life in his hometown had become dangerous and his situation precarious. And yet, God warns that even this environment would be nothing compared to Jerusalem. And Jerusalem was nothing compared to Babylon. And Babylon, nothing compared to Egypt. For every level, there is a different devil. And in order to meet these challenges, it would take training on Jeremiah's part. Wiersbe says this, the life of service gets better as we grow more mature. Each new challenge, horses, jungles, oppositions, war, help Jeremiah develop his faith and grow in his ministry skills. The easy life is ultimately the hard life because the easy life stifles maturity. But the difficult life challenges us to develop our spiritual muscles and accomplish more for the Lord. You see, that's what training does for a horse. It develops their muscles. Some of you are asking, why is God dragging you through this season when you should be asking, what is God developing in you in this season? Faith is like a muscle. The more you use it, the stronger it gets. God was developing Jeremiah's faith muscle, and perhaps God is developing yours too. You see, when horses are not racing, they're training. They don't stop training simply because there is no race. It's what you do in the meantime, in between time, that determines your success when you find yourself in battle. Let's make this tweetable. Between the provision and the promise is preparation. And the Lord promises this. The horse is made ready for the day of battle, but the victory belongs to the Lord. The Lord is training you right now for battle and training you for breakthrough. That does not happen on race day. That happens on regular days. When horses are not racing, they are training. When horses aren't racing, they're training to be led. Are you willing to let God take the lead today? Will you trust God when you can't trace God? In this season of uncertainty, are you willing to acknowledge God in all your ways and allow Him to direct your paths? When horses are not racing, they're being groomed. I spent more time grooming my horse than actually riding him. During this daily routine, I had the opportunity to get my hands on every inch of my horse and quickly assess his health. Grooming increases the human and animal bond. My horse wasn't required to do anything but stand there and relax. Quiet time with just me and him. Ooh, grooming sounds a lot like prayer and meditation to me. You've got to take a moment and allow God to groom you. Give God the opportunity to get His hands on you. Spend quiet time alone and forge the bond between you and your Father. I've come to learn that our success or failure when faced with opposition is not determined while we're in the throes of it, but rather how we prepare before we get in it. If you're going to compete with a horse, you've got to train like one. That's the only way that you'll triumph. Race horses are not simply born, they're bred. It's been said breeding race horses is as much of a science as it is an art. And breeders and horse owners spent countless hours studying pedigrees and analyzing the best sires to send their mares to in hopes of breeding a winner. And I think that somewhere along the way, Jeremiah forgot that he wasn't simply born, he was bred. God declares in chapter 1, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations." I want to remind somebody today, you were not simply born, you were bred. What you are on the cusp of, you were bred for. Where are you, First Baptist? Coach Junie Wingfield, before you were born, God set you apart and appointed you as an inspiration to children in this community and beyond. Denise Merchant, before you were born, God set you apart and appointed you as a gifted leader and speech therapist. Deacon Brown, before you were born, God set you apart and appointed you as a living testimony that you might win souls for Christ. Sister Laney, before you were born, God set you apart and appointed you to tell your story through liturgical dance. Eddie Dawson, before you were born, God appointed you and bred you for such a time as this when He knew we would be on the virtual platform. You were not just born, you were bred. Where are you, Bridge Nation? Who else am I talking to this morning? You were not born, you were bred. You were bred for entrepreneurship. You were bred to preach. You were bred to sing. You were bred to be an author. You were bred to be a community organizer. You were bred to inspire generations. You were bred to turn the world upside down. You come from an amazing pedigree. You were bred to win. I'm reminded of the movie Seabiscuit. Seabiscuit became one of the thoroughbred racing's greatest legends. But he didn't start out that way. In the film, the owner said the horse is too small, the jockey too big, the trainer too old, and I'm too dumb to know the difference. Seabiscuit was literally a dark horse. He was never supposed to be a champion. People had written him off as nothing but a training horse. He was weary, temperamental, and often misunderstood, but with a little training, a little grooming, and a whole lot of love, Seabiscuit proved to be a champion. It doesn't matter today how high the odds are stacked against you, you were bred to win. Maybe you were counted out as too small, too big, too old, or maybe too dumb. You were never supposed to make it. You weren't even supposed to make it past high school. You weren't supposed to amount to anything, but can you testify that with a little training, a little grooming, and a whole lot of love from Jesus, baby, look at you now. You are triumphant. Come on and raise your hands wherever you are and say, God picked a winner. I didn't come here to race. I came here to compete, and I've got the victory. I want to leave you with this. I can remember learning to ride and being taught by my father. And the thing that always stuck out for me was that my dad never made it easy. I never rode with a saddle for most of my training because my dad didn't want me to. He never wanted me to be that comfortable. He figured this: if I could endure the tough ride, if I could hold on when the bumps started, if I could learn to grasp firmly without falling, if I could learn to balance myself when the horse got slippery, if I would engage my core strength and tighten my muscles to hold on, then I would be all right. You see, he wanted me to learn how to get through the tough times. And he said, I did this so that when you finally got in the saddle, you'd be sitting pretty. Here's the lesson. There is no sitting pretty without preparation. One more time. There is no sitting pretty without preparation. God wants to know, can you endure the bumpy ride? God wants to know, will you dig in when things get a little too tough? God wants to know, will you exercise the foundation of your core strength that is Jesus Christ when things get a little bit rocky for you? Can you handle life without the saddle? There is no sitting pretty without preparation. And I also remember this. Whenever I fell off my horse, my dad would mosey to the field to check on me and assess my injuries. And once he knew I was all right, he would say this: you can't be a cowgirl without eating a little dirt. Get up and handle your horses. God bless you, Bridge Nation. At this time, I'm not opening the physical doors of the church. But I'm asking you to open your hearts and minds to receiving Jesus Christ. Every one of us has a horse. Every one of us has an obstacle that we believe insurmountable. But Jesus is our way over those obstacles. Jesus is the ever-present help in the time of trouble. Jesus wants to help you handle your horses. Jesus is the bit that controls the horse's movement. Jesus is the reins that slows things down for you a little bit and even stops it. So wherever you are today, I'm asking that you would commit your life to Christ, that you would connect to Jesus today. Wherever you are, you can raise your hands and say, Jesus, I'm turning it all over to you. I can't handle this horse on my own, but I know that you can. And so wherever you are, will you connect with us? The information is on the screen. Call us, email, text us. We want to connect with you as you make the decision to connect with Christ. We want to be your bonus family. We want to be the foot soldiers that help you not to break ranks. We want to help you keep the holes filled in, amen, so that the enemy does not infiltrate. That's what we want to do for you. And we're asking that you would give us a chance. But more importantly, Jesus is calling. Why not give him a chance? I'm so encouraged by this atmosphere today. I'm so encouraged that you all thought fit or saw fit to join us today. And no matter what you think is out of control, no matter what circumstance you're facing today, no matter what insecurities you have or what seems like you just can't conquer it, God wants you to know that the time has come for you to handle your horses. God bless you.